The PlayStation 2 is 20 years old now, released in North America. It got its original birthday back in March 4 in Japan this very same year, 20 years ago. But it wasn't released until October 26, today, 20 years ago, in North America. Now, the PlayStation 2 is my all-time favorite video game console, not only for its huge, enormous RPG library, but also because of its enormous and rich catalog of video games. It had every single genre you can imagine, even those naughty games that were kind of controversial, some weird-ass experiments, visual novels, shoot-em-ups, sports games, first-person shooters, RPGs, everything. And I know most consoles have this huge variety as well, but nothing did it like the PlayStation 2, because most other consoles of its time had a lot of video game genres, a lot of games released for them, but half of them were kind of mediocre, and most of the games released for the PlayStation 2, any given genre, were almost top-notch, were great games. I dare say between 70 and 80% of its video game library was really freaking good. Now, both the Super Nintendo and the PlayStation 1 were a monster. Monsters when it came to RPGs, very historically important. And by the time this great console was released, 20 years ago in the year 2000, the PlayStation 1 was still releasing great games. In fact, most of the top-notch, all-time classic, the best RPGs on the original PlayStation were released in the year 2000. However, over the course of time, the PlayStation 2 won the throne over the PlayStation 1 when it became a huge, important console and home for role-playing games all around the world, both Western RPGs, Japanese RPGs, and the PlayStation 1 was still amazing, but back then it was still very niche. Its RPGs weren't as popular as they are nowadays, and the PlayStation 2 made the genre very popular worldwide. However, sad but true, the PlayStation 2 had this very rough launch when it came to the genre. Back then, it only released 4 RPGs. One of them was Orphan Sign of Sorcery, based on an anime series that nobody knew. It was a game nobody asked for, nobody cared, and honestly, it wasn't great. It was not a bad RPG, but it wasn't great. It was far from great, as a matter of fact. It was one of those RPGs that tried to experiment a little with the genre. It kind of wanted to be between turn-based and real-time, but without menus. It was hard to get into, hard to understand, hard to control. The graphics looked a little bit bad. It was primitive, alright. It just wasn't showing the PlayStation 2 power. It was a mediocre game and a mediocre release. From Software released 2 RPGs for this system, initially. One of them was Eternal Ring, a first-person action RPG, similar to the Kingsfield series, but more Japanese than normal. Because the Kingsfield games felt more like Western style, just like the Dark Souls series, but Eternal Ring was like going back to this formula, this very same formula in first person, but looking more like a true Japanese anime style RPG. However, the game flopped, it wasn't good, it wasn't that great, it wasn't bad either. Again, we met a mediocre game. I myself, I'm not a fan at all of first-person video games, so my RPGs, I like playing them on third-person, every single one of them, with the exception of a few dungeon crawlers, but this game, it just controlled completely in first-person. Action RPG, it was low, it was boring, it just wasn't inspiring. It's not a terrible game, it just was a bad game. Next up, we've got Evergrace, an action RPG in third person where you can choose between two different characters, a guy and a girl. I played first with the guy, then went to the girl, and none of these characters convinced me. The gameplay was just boring, clunky, poorly designed. Evergrace was just a train wreck, as a matter of fact. It wasn't a terrible game, but it was kind of bad nonetheless. And last but not least, we got a Western RPG called Summoner. And Summoner was just the same situation as Evergrace. It was just clunky. I know nowadays people feel nostalgic when it comes to this game. A lot of people really enjoy this game. But back then, it just wasn't showing the PlayStation 2 power, the PlayStation 2 capacity. It was just, again, once again, a mediocre game that nobody wanted to play, nobody cared about. So in terms of RPGs, the PlayStation 2 had a really bad start, unfortunately. And it stayed that way for an entire year. Japan was starting to get good RPGs back in the day, but us, you know, in North America, we weren't getting anything relevant. We got Dark Cloud back in May 2001, I believe. early 2001, and it was okay. Dark Cloud was a revolutionary game, but again, it was a very niche game. Nobody cared for it, nobody played it. It didn't become like a cult classic until much later. And of course, because of this cover, everybody believed it was a Zelda clone. I mean, look at this guy with the green hat. I mean, of course he looked like, a little bit like Link. And he did play a little bit like Zelda, as a matter of fact, but he had a totally different focus. Dark Cloud was a good game, and it was the PlayStation 2 was a good home for it, but again, it just didn't meet anybody's expectations. Now, it wasn't until the end of 2001, over 1 year later after the release of this magnificent masterpiece of a console, that we started getting the first true great RPGs on the system. One of them was Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance, also released on the Xbox and later on the GameCube. This game was a huge commercial success, especially because it was one of those games that had a multiplayer adventure. Single player mode wasn't that fun, to be honest. I played the game and I was bored to pieces, but playing the game with somebody else really made a difference. This game was a very huge commercial success, people loved it, and then several days later we got Shadow Hearts. Shadow Hearts, however, nobody gave a shit about this game. Unfortunately, it got swallowed up in between Dark Alliance and Final Fantasy X, also released on December 2001. Even though this is my favorite RPG of that year, I fell in love with this game. Shadow Hearts was just amazing, almost a masterpiece, but Final Fantasy X, Baldur's Gate, Dark Alliance were just two enormous beasts that literally destroyed whatever chance Shadow Hearts had. But the point is, back at the end of 2001, over a year later after this PlayStation 2 release, it was back then when we finally started getting important RPGs, when we finally started seeing, okay, it might stand a chance against the PlayStation, because the original PlayStation still had a lot of great kick-ass RPGs, man. The PlayStation 2 only had 4 or 5. In 2002, however, we kept getting more RPGs. Japan was still getting all the great stuff, and we got it until 1 year later, sadly. So I'd say back in 2002 was the year when in Japan, at the very least in Japan, the RPG genre started really flourishing. And for us, we started getting more RPGs, so little by little, this console started competing against the original PlayStation. And back in 2001 was when most people had already forgotten about the PlayStation, had already moved on to the PlayStation 2, because Final Fantasy X was a huge success, because Shadow Hearts was there, because Dark Alliance was there, maybe Dark Cloud. And in this very same year, we got the famous and also infamous game, Kingdom Hearts. It shocked a lot of people, you know, a combination between Final Fantasy and Disney. Nobody was expecting that. It was a bizarre crossover, but it was a commercial success. People loved the game. It spawned a sequel some years later. It was a bigger, much better, etc. We also got the port of Grounded 2, originally released a couple of years before on the Dreamcast. That version was much better. The PlayStation 2 version had some issues, but it was great. We had a Grandia game on the PlayStation, a true successor to the original Grandia on the original PlayStation. We also got Wild Arms 3, very good game, cult classic nowadays. It stayed true to the Wild Arms name. It was a great game, definitely an iconic successor to the first two Wild Arms games on the PlayStation. And we also got The Mighty Suikoden 3. Now, Suikoden 3 had a lot of problems. It was the last RPG before he left Konami, developed by Yoshitaka Murayama, the original creator. It just felt very different from the original Suikoden 1 and 2, which were great games, specifically the second one, but this was 2002. Back then, nobody knew about this series. This series as a whole was a complete hidden gem. Back then, everybody was playing Kingdom Hearts, Final Fantasy X, Grandia 2, and dare I say Wild Arms 3. So Suikoden 1, 2, and 3 went under a lot of people's radars. Thankfully, several years later, Suikoden became huge. People start realizing that it was a great series, forgotten, abandoned, and whatnot. And Suikoden 2 became so hugely popular that a lot of people started paying attention to these other games. Suikoden 3, no matter how much I love it, was almost a masterpiece. Didn't convince a lot of people, but it did convince me, and I thought it was just great. And so the PlayStation 2, even though it had a slow start, and for several years we didn't get many of the great RPGs back. Well, it wasn't until 2004-5 when we finally saw the huge potential this console had. a lot of developers realized the PlayStation 2 was starting to sell like crazy. People loved the console, people wanted more, and obviously, of course, people wanted more of this genre, more of this amazing genre. Like I said before, so many great classics were left on the PlayStation, the original PlayStation, and other consoles like the Super Nintendo, the GameCube even, the Dreamcast, but it wasn't until the PlayStation 2 era came about that popularized the genre, and a lot of gamers worldwide started getting into RPGs, specifically Japanese RPGs. So all of these developers saw the potential and quickly started developing RPG after RPG after RPG because they were selling like crazy. In 2003, we got the first Disgaea that was the beginning of such an iconic series nowadays. We also got the first Xenosaga game, the successor to Xenogears, the mighty Xenogears. We also saw the start of the original Dot Hack. These were four games, three of them released on 2003 and the next one till 2004. These three games, even though they weren't a commercial success, they were still kind of successful, people paid attention, and it was the beginning again of one of the most iconic action RPG series back then. We then got Art of the Lad 4, Twilight of the Spirits, Dark Cloud 2, a much better sequel than the original game 2 years before. The next year we got Star Ocean 3, finally a successor to the original Star Ocean the Second Story on the PlayStation. We got Growlancer Generations, we got Shadow Hearts Covenant, Dark Alliance 2 came about also on other consoles, but a lot of people play that game on the PlayStation 2. And of course, how can I forget about Shin Megami Tensei Nocturne? It was back then when a lot of people started paying attention to this series because the previous two games were never released outside of Japan. It wasn't until we got Shin Megami Tensei 3, also known in Europe as Lucifer's Call, but in North America it was called Nocturne. And it was a commercial success, not as successful, still somewhat like a hidden gem, but it was the beginning of the Shin Megami Tensei trending in this area. And then some years later we got Persona 3, Persona 4, Growlancer Heritage of War, the trilogy of Xenosaga, Dot Hack GU, three fantastic games. I could go on forever. We got Final Fantasy 12 as well, Kingdom Hearts 2. It was a great time to be alive as an RPG gamer. And it will go on until 2013. The PlayStation 2 wasn't discontinued until 2013. 13 years of PlayStation 2 games. When it comes to RPGs, however, the last game released for this console was Sakura Wars, but it was more like a visual novel, experiment, puzzle, it was everything, a cross-genre, but it was also, at its core, a role-playing game. Sakura Wars was released also on the Wii. I've covered this game to death, to pieces, I love it, but that was the last game. And because it had so many RPGs, specifically Japanese RPGs, the PlayStation 2 became like the mother of hidden gems, because most of its RPGs were kind of unknown, kind of underrated. Most of them weren't as well known as they were today. Like I said before, back then, Shin Megami Tensei Nocturne was more of a hidden gem. Digital Devil Saga, Growlancer, the Growlancer games are still hidden gems nowadays. Radiata Stories. Some of these games were unknown to people. It wasn't until PlayStation 3 came about, PlayStation 4 era, when the genre completely exploded into a huge commercial success. And then people finally started paying attention to PlayStation 2 RPGs that were kind of underrated, forgotten, unknown, obscure, hidden gems. It was just awesome. Sadly, because of the pandemic, a lot of the prices of these RPGs went up a hell of a lot this very same year. And I believe that the time to collect RPGs for the PlayStation 2 is over. You can still get some of them for a decent price, like $20 or less. But most of them are like the classic RPGs everybody knows, like Final Fantasy X, Kingdom Hearts, while the others are like the ones nobody cares about, like Evergrace, Orphan, Eternal Ring, dirt cheap RPGs. They aren't great. We still need several ports and remakes of these games, several re-releases, at the very least digital. Some of them have been there on the PlayStation 4 already, some of them were on the PlayStation 3, but we need more of them because it was such an important console for this genre, the true home of role-playing games. Thanks to this, it got a reputation of being the king of RPGs, most specifically for Japanese RPGs. Is it still the king nowadays? The Switch is getting there. I mean, when it comes to quantity, it's shocking, but the PlayStation 2, in quantity, is no longer the king of RPGs. That honor goes to the PlayStation 4. The Switch is getting there. But that's because I'm counting, obviously, indie RPGs, digital-only RPGs. These two consoles, PlayStation 4 and Switch, have been embracing the genre with all its love and might. But what about the quality? Well, the Switch is getting there. I think it needs a little bit more time, maybe a couple of years more, to keep releasing amazing RPGs. The PlayStation 4, however, I dare say I love the PlayStation 4. I think it has an overly and utterly amazing RPG library on par with the PlayStation 2. Out of nostalgia, I'm gonna keep saying that the PlayStation 2, at the very least in my heart, it's still the king of RPGs, but that's because I've been playing RPGs and I've been with this console for at least 15 years and I've only had the PS4 for like 3 years. But I think the PS4 is now, objectively speaking, the true king of RPGs because it has a lot of them, like over 100 Japanese role-playing games, and at the very least 70% of them are great. But there is one place, only one place in my heart for a true king, and that is the mighty PlayStation 2. That's it for this video, people. Thank you very much for watching. I know I promised to rank the entire PlayStation 2 JRPG library. It would have been a great idea to rank it on this 20th anniversary for the North American release, but I'm still missing a few games. I'm still missing like 5 games that I need to play to properly rank every single Japanese role-playing game released in North America. I'm planning on doing that video by the end of the year, maybe before Christmas. So, it's gonna be amazing. Long live this amazing console. Love it to pieces. Great catalog, great library, great power, great graphics, great RPGs, great everything. I love the PlayStation 2, and I'm pretty sure so do you. See you next time!